Oh, wonderful. Oh, forgive me. Yeah. You're an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Wonderful. What are you doing?
So I know you are very busy before day, but you come here for a good cause.
and all the volunteers, all the donors and all the supporters and staff. But am I had honor to introduce the mayor?
Not yet.
See, I'll tell you that good yet. All right, but that's okay. I am proud to share with you that I have an inner geek too. Before becoming a councilman, I worked in design engineer at Dinuba Computers. If some of you may remember, no, too old, very few. So I just stopped by some booths and I saw some young talent and I admire so much. Therefore, on behalf of the 27 and the city, and later on with the dignitary, welcome and thank you very much. And I wish you success. And what I would love to is, I see more of this event happening here and everywhere, and see you even next year, better one too. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Because I think you're going to be pretty impressed as you see the changes over the next several months. Already, great things are happening. And they're happening because incredible people in the community are reaching out to us and saying, hey, can we try this? Can we do this? One of those folks is Rishi Kumar, who reached out to us a little over a year ago, right? And said, my son's working on this incredible project. And he launched the Silicon Valley Coders Club. I think at that point you had it in Saratoga and Livermore. And said, hey, let's try this in San Jose. And of course, Jill said, absolutely, let's make it happen. And I know many of you are now members of the Coders Club. The first day, of course, we had 200 folks cramming in the doors because we saw there was so much pent-up demand here in San Jose. And so obviously, we want to make this grow, and opportunities like this can grow. And this is critically important for us. I know I'm preaching to the choir here, but we have extraordinary opportunities in this valley like nowhere else in the world. And we want to make sure everyone in our community can take advantage of those opportunities. How many of you guys have ever downloaded an app? Raise your hand. Yeah, I know, pretty dumb question, right? Everybody's downloaded an app. So how many of you have uploaded an app before? Uploaded your own app. Uploaded, oh, we got one, all right. We got two, three, we got a few. Fantastic. So here's our goal. We want to create, out of all the consumers of technology here in our city, we want to imagine how we can have creators of technology rise from our neighborhoods, right? And all of you brilliant young people who are consuming technology, you're downloading apps, we want to see how you can put your creative energies to work and be uploaders, not just downloaders, right? So that's our challenge, collectively. It's how we can create an incredible creative force within our community. And we're doing it in lots of ways, and of course, the work of Silicon Valley Coders Club is instrumental in all that. And I'm going to get back to the Coders Club in just a moment. I do want to make sure everyone is aware of an awful lot that's going on here. In addition to the competition, I know that will be happening today at 4:15. We are doing lots of things here in the city of San Jose, trying to encourage innovation in various ways from people of all ages, young and old. Just a few weeks ago, we launched an initiative called Unleash Your Geek. And I think Councilmember Tamlin was referring to this earlier. We all have an inner geek within us. We want to find ways to be able to employ our innovative sides to approach challenges that we face in our community and to address those challenges in new ways. So we launched this with the help of the Silicon Valley Community Foundation, the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, to see if we can encourage creative folks, particularly in our schools, to come forward with ideas that can solve problems in our community. And the first problem we've got that we've announced, we're going to try to spur this competition on toward, is to address graffiti over our freeways. Right? We all see graffiti as we're driving down 101 and 280. It's all over. There's freeway overpasses and the railroad trellises, and it's awful, right? And here's the challenge. In order to send somebody up there to clean it, Caltrans tells us they have to shut down the entire freeway because it's not safe to send somebody up there. And so we got to find more creative ways of doing this. And we think there's probably a pretty simple device that could paint out that graffiti without having to put somebody in peril on top of a bridge and having to shut down a freeway. Because after all, that takes months to get authorization and get through the red tape. And so we've reached out to our local high schools, to our local universities, San Jose State and Santa Clara, and their engineering departments. And we put the challenge forward. Unleash your geek. Create a device that can enable us to paint out the graffiti on our freeway overpasses, right? So that's the challenge. And I suspect you're going to see some pretty interesting designs, maybe a couple drones, who knows? And we've got money to help competitors create prototypes that we'll be able to test. And then, of course, we've got a reward as well. And what we hope is that we're going to have the creator of this device here in San Jose, and they'll be able to patent it right down the street, our U.S. Patent and Trademark Office, and then they're going to make billions of dollars, and we'll be able to say we knew them when. So that's our first challenge. We've got lots more challenges, and they don't involve money necessarily. They involve creativity and innovation, because we know that's what we have in abundance here in our community. So I really want to congratulate all of the young men and women who are coming forward to participate in this effort, whether it's Coders Club or any of the other endeavors we've got here. We really appreciate the fact that you're rolling up your sleeves to be a part of it. And I really want to thank your parents in particular for supporting you in this, because it's a beautiful day out there and they could be hanging out, finding that local swimming pool or something. And instead, you guys are here, which says an awful lot. So thank you to everybody who's participated. Now, I have to thank one young man in particular who's been really instrumental in all of this, who is the founder of the Silicon Valley Coders Club. He's just a sophomore at Saratoga High School. That's not bad, right? In addition to being a sophomore at Saratoga High School, he's participated in many other activities. He's playing soccer. I think you're in a band, is that right, Shivaum? Yes. So Shivaum Kumar started this program 2 years ago? Last year, and already it has grown incredibly in three cities and growing. And we're thrilled to have you here in San Jose. And this is exactly the kind of entrepreneurial effort that we love to see in San Jose, and we want to do everything we can to encourage it. And so I wanted to offer you this commendation on behalf of the 1 million residents of the city of San Jose, to thank you for stepping up and engaging all of us and expanding your community.
Incredible leadership to San Jose. Do we all agree with that?
Yeah.
The winds of change are sweeping San Jose, and it's largely attributed to the leadership that Sam brings to the table. And he's got a very progressive ideas for the city. He constantly is talking about how we can make opportunities for the kids of San Jose. And he's thinking, he's a thinking man, and he's making change happen in a very, very positive way. So let's give a big round of applause for Sam. I do want to say one more thing, which is, there is one more reason why I really, really like Sam. And the reason is because, I was actually campaigning a couple years back, and I was knocking on doors. And I land up in a front yard and I see Sam Licardo for mayor sign there. And that was, his parents live in Saratoga. And so I ended up having a great conversation about Sam and about Saratoga issues and challenges. And that probably set my campaign on the right path. So I owe Sam a lot. So thanks, Sam. Thank you, Jill. Thank you, Dan. And Shivaum, you want to come up?
Yeah. I'd like to shake your hand, man. You're awesome. Excuse me.
Thank you so much.
I want to take a picture with all of you, so you all stand up.
All right.
Yeah.
Oh, so let's have the audience all stand up.
Okay.
Thank you.
hundreds of governments in Asia, and still funding as well as that. Hi everyone, my name is Monson Cutler. I'm the founder of a company called Money Intel, which is helping solve America's retirement problem. So in short, we want to help every company offer a high quality retirement plan without the administrative burden and cost of doing so, and also empower employees to invest for their retirements with the confidence and financial advice they need.
Hi everyone, I'm
Silicon
Sound Solutions. I'm the business
experience and figuring out a solution for them.
So here with she and Shivaum and the whole team has done a great job seeing that there's a lack of access for kids actually be able to solve problems. And so when I had the opportunity to help teach some of the San Jose sessions, I saw these kids were really excited about making a difference in the community, helping increase volunteerism, etc., decreasing the amount of trees that were being cut down. And so that's ultimately what I think entrepreneurship is, finding the problem and solving it. And that's what we're doing at ERX right now. Basically, people can't afford their prescription medication. When we started the company, our CEO went to get medicine from the local pharmacy, and one pharmacy said it was $250. The pharmacy across the street said it was $350. And then he went to the final pharmacy, and they chased him out the door saying, oh, okay, whatever you can afford to pay. And so ultimately, there's clearly some price that individuals can't afford to pay. And over 40% of prescriptions remain unfulfilled at the pharmacy because people can't afford them. And that's what we're working on here. It's trying to help people get access to their medication, but getting into the
Yes, I think we got a lot of good information. As they all talked about how stuff like this is very important for being a successful entrepreneur, and how we had all these kids coming this last semester have that motivation to work. So I'll move on to our next question. So what are some like technology trends you see in the Valley that can help exciting career after many of these kids?
The length of a career has progressively shortened in the last 100 years, I would say. In my grandfather's or my parents' generation, I think we could have had a career in the same industry for about 50 years. Increasingly, those trends are getting shorter to about a decade. What was hot 10 years ago in the software industry is, I don't know, probably web development, maybe app development, which is the life cycle of that is progressively shorter. So whatever we tell you today will probably not be the hot thing 10 years from now. But with that in mind, I'm happy to talk about what is hot right now. I'm sure you guys are following all the top trends in TechCrunch across the world, but macro trends, which I'm really excited about, is the medicine industry and the marriage of technology and medicine. An example that I will leave you, an idea that I will leave you with today is the use of prosthetics is starting to increase in the industry where we're minimizing disability. But think about the possibility that prosthetics can bring where you're creating upside for the human body. I'm not talking cyborg level craziness, I'm talking simple augmentation of things like memory. So much of our time we spend in school trying to learn things. But is memory truly the living barrier? It is probably information retrieval at this point, and why are we not taking that memory away from the situation? Something to think about, something for you guys to write technology on.
I think one of the large trends in the area currently is sort of the democratization of knowledge and access to information for everyone. So if you look at it, there are all these startups and educational institutions out there which are basically offering their courses for free to students and everyone. And so sort of as time has progressed, nowadays everyone is sort of becoming generalists, most successful entrepreneurs, and they sort of build their own product first by themselves to check if it will work. And so I think a trend that the current generation should latch on to is getting access to all this information and learning about it so that they can actually use it and create their products and solve their problems themselves instead of relying on someone else. And I think another trend that's a pretty sort of big trend right now is the shared economy and sharing in general. The idea of Uber, Lyft, Airbnb, I think more and more will move into that direction where people are letting their vehicles be used for letting other people use their vehicles when they're not using them, letting other people use their houses when they're not using them, etc. So I think the shared economy is a pretty big trend.
So I'm going to take a completely different approach to this question. And I think that they cover the technology trends really well. But I think that what makes a great entrepreneur is really working on a problem that is very meaningful to you. I know I'm speaking to an audience of middle school and high school students, so I'm going to think of it as an approach to how you should think about college in your first couple of years out. And so there was a Princeton University professor who did a study of the students that went to Princeton and the students that got into Princeton but couldn't attend. And so I know all of us are very heavily focused on, God, my kids have to go to Stanford, they have to go to Harvard, they have to go to the top Berkeley, they have to go to the top schools in the country. And what he actually found was over the 20 years that he analyzed the students who got into Princeton and those who actually couldn't attend, there was actually no difference in the income or career results of those individuals. And I think what you take away from that is that you either have the work ethic and the motive to work and make something of yourselves. And I think that we place too high of a consensus on what schools can do for us, as opposed to what our own natural abilities are to make of the surroundings. And so, you know, today it might be the shared economy or autonomous driving or some really cool technology. But I think another way to think about it is what interests us is really the thing that we should pursue. And I know there's a whole gradient to, you know, what does that mean? But I can tell you of, you know, the few hundred companies that we work with the 401k plans, probably one of the most profitable companies that we work with is a janitorial company. That all they do is go to companies' office spaces and clean their office space and make sure that their office is clean. And so we can spend all this time talking about, you know, what's the next great technology company or what's the next great app that we can build, but it's really about what is a business that you want to put effort and you want to put time into. And we hear, I hear a lot of stories. I work with a number of kids about the stress in Palo Alto school districts and the Saratoga school districts and the dozens of kids in the Palo Alto schools that committed suicide and have fueled this pressure and this endemic. I think that endemic comes from trying to compete with what is a success and what is hot, and not is what is something that I want to do and what do I want to push myself to be the best in. And I think if you rephrase the question, it's not as what is the next best technology or what is the next best thing that I should be working on, but what is a skill that I want to perfect myself? What is something that I want to be the best at? I think that you can still achieve the same level of success without feeling the pressure that comes with it. And just to cap that off, I know the Golden State Warriors are on their way to being the next champions. Steph Curry, who's the MVP, you would think that he's a natural talent. His father played in the NBA. He's been one of the best basketball players since college. He made it to the Final Four. And he's this is the second time he won the MVP in the NBA. But you would be shocked on a daily basis, he shoots something like 300 practice shots every single day. And if you think about what that means on an annual basis, he's shooting 100,000 shots every single year. And so when you say he has the fastest release in the NBA, he's able to make a higher percentage of three-pointers and free throws than any other NBA player in history, it's not an accident that Steph Curry is the best basketball player in the NBA. It's come after repetition of shooting 100,000 shots every single year for the last 20 years, and 20 years later he's the best basketball player in the world. And so that, I think that's a really long way of saying is it doesn't matter what's hot today or what your friends are telling you is hot. The most disruptive companies in the world, people thought were the worst ideas when they first started. And so focus on what you find pleasurable, what you find is your passion, and the success and the work will come with it.
Yeah, it's very important. The topic we've been stressing this past semester in our boot camp, following your passion, all your projects, all the teams have been focusing on that and enjoying what they're doing. So thank all the panelists for coming here today.
Operations. technology organizations. She earned her bachelor's and master's degree in mechanical engineering from Carnegie Mellon University. Next, we would like to invite Nandini Ramani, VP Engineering of Twitter, to take the stage. Software across enterprise and social media organizations. She also owns product strategy for emerging markets, particularly India. Next, we would like to invite Shobana Radhakrishnan, Director of Engineering, Channel Store and Billing Systems at Roku. She is the founder and CEO of TechSpark, a nonprofit organization focused on promoting STEM diversity. She is an active industry speaker and has a master's degree in computer science from the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And last but not least, Kamla Subramanian, a cloud technologist. Her focus is on speed, scalability, and reliability in the public cloud. She recently completed a successful tenure as principal architect at Azure Networking at Microsoft, where she was responsible for the success of software for open networking in the cloud, or SONET. She has a master's and a PhD from North Carolina State University in computer engineering.
Products and as the consumer products get easier to use than the products that are getting sold to companies. Gets that much easier. So the kids in this in all the cities here in San Jose and around the country, your adoption of new technology is really helping to speed up the cycle in very large companies. So keep doing it.
Thank you. Hang on to the microphone. We'll have a second question. When you think back, who was your favorite woman role model that inspires you or continues to inspire you?
Well, I have to say my mom. So when I was growing up, my dad was an engineer, my mom was a stay-at-home housewife, but you know, between my father and myself, we have 4 engineering degrees, and my mother always came up with the best technical solutions of anything that was happening in our household. But just the ability, the faith that she always put in me of just, you can do anything. Just go do it. You know, no fuss, no worry, just go do it. And I think that's the biggest gift we can instill in our kids, of just the faith in themselves to go try and succeed, and you will succeed at anything that you do.
Yeah, I have to say, with my grandmother, at one point I want to raise her. Unlike my other 3 panelists, I went to school in India. So somebody at the previous panel was talking about, you don't have to go to, not that you don't have to, you should, if that's your dream and that's what you aspire for, but not everybody on this panel is from an Ivy League, for instance, or whatever it is you seek. So I want to say that you can make your dreams come true no matter what. So you just have to persist. And my grandmother was my role model. She didn't even have much of an education. She studied until the 5th standard, which is a thing in India, like 5th grade here. And she was in India before the partition happened, when they split Pakistan and India. For those of you who want to go read up on some geography, I would encourage you to do that. And so she was my role model, believe it or not. And even to this day, when I make some of the decisions I do, I still look to some of the things I learned from her at her knee when I was like 5 years old, 7, and so on and so forth. So and since then, of course, I've had many role models, not just women. And this I would say, especially for the young girls here, don't always look just to women, other women. It's awesome, because as Sheryl Sandberg says, you cannot be what you cannot see. So you have to see other women in order to know that you can be like that. However, also look at the men around you, because there's lots to be learned from them, and believe it or not, there's lots you can teach them as well. So definitely do that.
Thank you so much for pointing out the importance of the influence that we have on each other. And for the young men in the audience, just remember, the girls who are sitting next to you or who are in this room today, one day will be your colleagues, so you can help each other, right?
Or our boss.
Or your boss.
That's really important. I think everybody influences each other. It's something I have seen my mom really embrace growing up. I would say there are 2 role models that I remember when I grew up. One is my mom, because I think what we now call social capital, she had and has plenty of it, but I don't think she knows it now. She just happens to have it. So she has been a great example of achieving what you want to do with the resources you have. That's something you don't get taught in engineering school. You learn in the industry, and that's what's going to make you successful eventually, because you're never going to have all the resources you need or access to people or time or anything all the time. And so figuring out a way to achieve your career goals or what you want to accomplish with your efforts with what you have. I think that's something I learned from her. And the other question I'd like to mention is what we call the principal of our high school. I spent 12 years watching her. I went to the same school from the 1st grade to the 12th grade, which is very common in India. And I've seen in her a solid person whom I've always seen as being calm, even when she had a lot of challenges. She taught me discipline and education, discipline and time management. And I'm still in touch with her. I still visit her regularly. So she's been a big influence in my life.
Thank you for your answer.
For me, it was my math teacher, Mrs. Samuel. She was from Kerala. She had a very funny accent. But what was so important about her was basically, this was the late 80s, early 90s in India. She never made a distinction. She never had favorites. She picked three of us. There was me and a pair of my best friends, a pair of identical twins, Andrew Chapman and Andrew Chapman. And she created fierce competition in us. You know, and she didn't care, you know, whether we were girls or boys. It was still a very patriarchal society growing up at that time. And I remember, you know, the kind of competition she created with us. And she tried to make us strive, you know, score the highest. And just like the high school principal, she worked till her last day. She battled cancer. She came to school. I used to meet her when I went back home as well. And she really set a very good example for women in technology. And my love for math and science today is because of her. So I'm very grateful.
Thank you so much for your answer. Now, hang on to the microphone. If you could help me just think back in time. Just only 2 years ago, when you were in high school, did you know that you would be making a living out of the high tech world?
Yes, and that wasn't because I was clairvoyant or I knew exactly what I wanted to do. Growing up in India, again, back in the late 80s and early 90s, if you had a shot at making it, you'd have to choose a field in the high tech sector. So I knew that I was either going to be an engineer or a doctor growing up, and this is one of the choices that I really respect my parents, you know, trusting it on me, if you will, because it's been a fantastic journey. I think being in the high tech sector, especially to women with flexible work hours, you know, great pay, abundant jobs, it's a dream come true.
I grew up watching my dad, who was a mechanical engineer, so I used to help him fix things around the house. He used to fix TVs or scooters or anything that's engineering, not even electronics for example. He just liked figuring things out. And I was his sort of unpaid assistant with him. So I enjoyed that. And then in high school, like Kamala said, I had the choice of either being a doctor or an engineer. Basically, in India, you can actually apply to both schools and get admission, and I did get admission. But I enjoyed logic more than memorizing a lot of things, and so I thought that's what I wanted to do for the rest of my life. So I think I had an idea. So that's how it went on.
I think the same is true for me. I always knew I'd end up in something technology related, because other than that, I practically know nothing. Not a great cook, I'm not into gardening, nothing. I have a graveyard of plants. So I always knew that I would do something in technology. But I have to say, it wasn't like I knew where I'd end up. If you look at my own journey, I started in hardware, went to software, did a lot of work in enterprise, and then came to consumer. So I would say, don't expect that you know everything and you can predict like 64 moves up in chess. It's not, life isn't like that. You just have to have some gut feeling. And especially now more than ever, all of these industries are like blended into each other. So you can be a musician and still use technology. I have a friend actually who's in the Broad Institute at MIT. He works, believe it or not, on genome and like biotech. And everything he does using software. So you could choose to be anything, and you might still, I would encourage you to learn technology no matter what you decide to do. Even if you want to sell flowers and have a boutique or whatever, you still need to know technology. So no matter what, more than my time, today for all of you, I think it's important, whatever you choose to do.
That's a great point. Thank you.
So I'm another one, did a lot of math and science in high school. So I knew in general the direction around engineering, that's where I was going to go, but not specifically, I just kept going and you figure it out as you go. To your point though around learn a lot of different things, that is, I think that's one of the most important things for kids to understand and even adults that are working to understand, because you can be much more valuable and much more creative to yourself and the company that you're working for the more you understand how different pieces fit together. So never let yourself really get pigeonholed of this is the one specific thing that I know and this is, I'll just stay in that box. Really take every opportunity that you can to learn a little bit about everything.
Thank you so much. So diversity to learn.
Kind of at one point, I think I just want to reinforce, especially for the really young kids here, don't let society dictate anything. Don't let somebody make the decision that because you made a choice and went into liberal arts or something, that you can never be a technologist, because none of that is true. And so it's very easy to get into this spiral of making choice, saying, oh, I didn't get into this school, and hence this, and hence that. There is no such thing. Especially now, more than ever, for all of you, that is certainly not true. So dream big.
You didn't change your mind if you answered. Thank you. And I think the next question is quite important for our parents out there, because sometimes we're not sure what is best for our kids. So the question is, we see kids constantly glued to smartphones and tablets. Is that a huge plus or a huge negative?
I think it's a huge plus, without a doubt.
Kids!
You abuse anything and it's going to be a detriment to you. I use smartphones and apps to teach my kids. I remember the way I learned coding. I would take a bus. I was in Bangalore, I would take a bus. I would travel 45 miles to 45 minutes to a person who had a computer, and he would teach me lines of Pascal and Fortran. I don't know if any of you remember those languages, but basic Fortran and Pascal, and it was tedious. My love for computer engineering, which has started at the delicate age of 15 and 16, didn't materialize until I was 22 and 23. Today, I use scratch.edu, I use Salcons, I use Code for Fun. I use these to teach my kids programming languages. And what it does is, instead of giving you 50 lines in gibberish, it gives you small blocks of if then else, for blocks, while loops, and then, you know, you can program, you can code a fun game. My son, who's in third grade, just recently created this game with a lion and then 10 cats, and they fight, and how the cats actually win over this ferocious lion using scratch.eu. He also has watches endless hours of Minecraft videos on it, which I think is crazy. But he gets those minutes every time he finishes a programming language. So I think it's definitely a plus. It's here to stay for sure. Things have changed a lot. I mean, I think when I tried to focus on my son's handwriting, I realized how little he'd be writing compared to what he did. And then now with touch screens and stuff, I realize how little they'll even be typing, speaking with voice memos and touch screens. So it's here to stay, and I think we should make the best use of it and use to our advantage.
Thank you. It's important that it's okay for them to be on the computer or tablet, but to make it a useful time, quality time. So not just play video games, kids, okay?
I would say devices are not the most instruction that human reason has to face, right? If you look at material from a few decades ago, people looked down upon these fiction books over books that have the material. And then there was TV without the remote, which gave you a few hours of distraction every day, and then parents were worried about that. And then when you had hundreds of channels and 20 hours of programming, parents worried about that. And now it's devices. I would say it depends on how they use it, not the fact that they have access to it. I would agree with Kamala that devices are taking them to the next level. Like Mail Sam was saying earlier, you play with apps and you find a gap, and that's when you feel motivated to upload an app yourself, because something is not satisfying you. So there's motivation because you're exposed to the latest, and there's something missing, and then you push it forward. And also I feel that the children of this generation are really well informed with their friends. Compared to how many friends I knew, what kinds of conversations I had, they're always in touch. They know the latest clubs in the area, they know the latest programming classes in the area, and they decide where to hang out together, and which mostly seem to be good things. And I feel that they have much better access to information because devices are closely accessible to them. So I definitely see it as the way forward.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, I don't think it's the devices in particular. Actually, frankly,
all the youngsters here. But I think if you look at this audience here, we have baby boomers, we have Gen Xers, millennials, and Gen Z, and even Gen Alphas here, some really young kids. And so I think it's just us adapting to the new and the next set of distractions, and then having the same sort of guidelines on what's acceptable, whether it's devices or whatever the next thing is. It could be drones, it could be things floating inside your body, whatever. You know, all of these things are coming, you know, with Oculus and stuff, you're gonna have other kind of stimulations that are going to be distractions. So whether we like it or not, there's always progression and there's always distractions. So some of it, I think, is of course spurring the kids so they learn not to spend too much time on it. However, I think a big part of it is also us adapting to the change and recognizing that it's not the land we grew up in, and adapting to that as well. So that's at least my way of thinking of it, is to let the kids be and learn to adapt.
Thank you for your insight.
Yeah, there always is a learning curve for the adults as different technology comes out. It's just, like everybody was saying, it's always a balance, and making sure folks, the kids just don't focus on one thing, but really give them, help them, encourage them to get a broad set of experiences. So not just from the phone, but from interaction, from meeting with other folks. So it's a great advantage, and that with the rest of the ecosystem and everybody else that can
Thank you so much. And our final question is, what do you see as the future of Silicon Valley if you had a crystal ball?
The future of Silicon Valley, we need Mayor Sam up here at this point. I've looked in a lot of different places across the US and in Europe, and when I moved out here 10 years ago, I was used to moving different cities, different states, different geographies every 2 years. And once I got out here, it's like, I could really stay here. This is actually quite cool. Because it's such a creative area. There's so many bright people to interact with, so many different ideas. And I think it's the challenge and the opportunity for all of us to make sure that we're continue to bring that creative energy to everything that we're doing, our work lives and our community. And that will be how we keep this going, because it is a very, very special place, and it's all of our responsibility to maintain that.
Well, I don't know about crystal ball, but definitely I hope by the time I'm older and can't drive anymore, we'll definitely have self-driving cars at a minimum, because it's already hard enough having me on the roads. So you definitely don't want me on a meeting. And I think there'll be like a lot of, you know, self-regulated glucose levels, there'll be a lot of innovation in the bio, you know, areas where the body's, like somebody was talking about a sidebar. I don't know about that, but certainly I think more and more, I have this aunt who's 90 years old, and so she was saying at this point, I think a higher percentage of my body is not mine that I was born with. So literally, she had her hips replaced and knees, and all of these are fine, and people live with it for 30, 40 years. And so absolutely, I think more and more of us, we're going to be able to live without the parts we're used to. And I think innovation in medicine and bio and others are going to be huge. And of course, the whole social environment and self-driving cars and drones and so on and so forth. These we can see today because these have already started. You know, there's so many projects that are going on. But I'm sure hoping that all of you youngsters will be innovating things from like the fantasy land of Game of Thrones and Star Wars and things that we can't even think about today, but will be a reality. At least I firmly believe that's where we're headed.
I agree. I think Silicon Valley has been pushing the edge of everything for the rest of the world, and I think that's what we're trying to do, just because look at the number of people who are here. And this is very unique, and I think that will continue in Silicon Valley. And we'll also continue and also push the envelope of diversity. I want to see, or at least dream of, a day where women being successful or being leaders in technology is not a matter of means anymore, but just a way people find normal operations. So I hope that Silicon Valley plays a bigger role there than the social.
That's an important point, and I think if you look around in this room, there are lots of young girls here?
I think if I live to be a 90, I'm going to see a Jetsons board. The Silicon Valley is the hub of innovation. I've had the opportunity to work with people in different parts of the world with all talented and stuff, but the real thing happens here. As a technologist, there's no better place to learn, grow up, and have a career as in Silicon Valley. So just to put it in layman's term, what I see is I see self-driving cars, like she said. I also see hopefully flying cars to meet the traffic, especially 85 to 37, 880. I see doctors being able to perform surgeries on patients hundreds of miles away with the use of robots and the HoloLens. I see us spending a lot of time on Oculus. I see drones dropping off my shipment. I see technology making my life so simple, but at the same time, ever so complicated to use. I don't see televisions anymore in our destiny. I definitely think streaming is also going to undergo a lot of changes. It's not going to be coming in from server to cloud and pipes. I'm going to see education changing. I'm going to see the way that our kids study is so different from the way we study. They'll be using their hands less, they'll be using their brains more, because anthropologically we've seen that every generation gets smarter than the previous generation. And I really hope that all of us get on the bandwagon and be a part of it, one way or the other, whether it's as technology contributing or actually a great form of contributing for consumerism. So definitely.
Thank you so much. Let's give these ladies a round of applause. Happy guests for you and also for the opportunity. More than 20 years of experience in telecommunication and networking. He holds a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from the University of Calgary. And our last panel of experts, I'd like to invite Ronnie Hulu, Chief Product Officer of Comprehensive Films. The company builds software for the life science industry to speed clinical trials to help get medicine to patients sooner. She has a bachelor and master's in engineering from Stanford University. Her nonprofit work includes improved educational outcomes for underprivileged children in Santa Clara. Let's give them a round of applause. And we would like to invite Shivaum to
becoming
more horizontal. So in the old days, when he talked about we are from the tech industry, it was dubbed as a vertical. Today, there is not a single industry that technology doesn't touch. So in that sense, technology touches us every second of our waking up, so to speak, as Kelly and Ronnie gave some wonderful examples. So the way I would look at it is, we all need to focus on improving technology and coming up with like more creative ways of problem solving, whatever the problem can be. But the one word of caution I'd also give is, let's not create the problem or proliferate the problem of us becoming slaves of technology. Because that's one thing that I really, really worry about, especially when I see so many children out in the crowd. I don't see a lot of us going out on the streets and playing, engaging with friends, doing things that does not involve technology to stimulate our brains will allow us to create a better technology in my opinion.
Thanks very much. So the way I would look at this is that technology is all across the endeavor of humanity. It, from farming to transportation to food service to personalized medicine. Technology is, I know people in startups in each of those areas, and those people are here in this valley, and they're cross-fertilizing their ideas across those industries. What used to be vertical silo industries are now all learning from each other. And so this rate of change that is going to happen in our lifetimes is going to continue to accelerate. And where there's going to be more and more discoveries all the time, and it's going to dramatically change our health. It's going to dramatically change our standard of living.
Good afternoon. So it's really hard to add to all of that. What I will add, though, is why do we see this proliferation of technology, right? We've had a lot of the capabilities that we see today around us, processing, communication, that's been around quite some time. I'm gonna wear a shirt that says, I was IoT for IoT school, because we've had this stuff for quite some time. And to add to what you just said, it's the economic changes that we see around us that's causing this technology to be everything we need around. The cars, the thermostats, the farming, and some data points to show the cost of processing has gone down 50x in the last 10 years. The cost of bandwidth, comms bandwidth, has gone down 40x. The cost of sensors has gone down 2x in the last 10 years. And so if you just look at all the economic change that's happening around us, the variables are all in place to enable us to make our lives a lot safer, easier, and actually make a change that's going to sustain our environment for the long term.
Yeah, so I really like what Jerome Christian said about how we can't be slaves of technology and all those kids have to make sure you go use technology at home all the time. You still have to be outside and go with your friends. So now for our next question is, why is the software team in Silicon Valley, do you see that changing? And then what's your, how should the you compare for software?
Absolutely, software is
the
game. I work for Intel, and I work in a processing environment where silicon was king for a long time. It's irrelevant. Really what matters is the software. That's the brains behind it. The silicon is a means to an end. And I hate to say that because that's my background for the last 20 years, but it's a means to an end. The software is what defines what the usability is. It defines the interface. It's the AI, right, that goes behind it, the artificial intelligence. Software is where it all is. Now, obviously, there's lots and lots of hardware that goes behind it, lots and lots of silicon technology that goes behind it. And so I don't want to underestimate what we do for a living. But again, when it comes down to it, I would encourage the youth to not only have a hardware background, but combine it with a software background. I have a degree in computer engineering, which is a degree in electrical engineering and a minor in computer science. I wasn't brilliant enough to know that this is what was going to happen 20 years down the line, but I wouldn't change that for anything. I think that's exactly what it enables me to do.
So I'm going to start off with an anecdote. When I was in 11th grade, I went to a National Science Foundation summer program. I was super excited about chemistry, so I went and worked with a chemical engineering professor. And what he had me do was write software. And as soon as I started writing software, I said, to heck with this chemistry stuff, okay? So the bottom line is, all areas of human endeavor, as we evolve our knowledge base in those areas, we evolve technologies, and those technologies are embodied with software. So software is in everything. It's in biotech, it's in automotive, it's in manufacturing, it's in mining. I mean, you just can't name an industry that does not use software as its foundation.
Both of you said really well in the context of software. The way I would describe it is, think of software as the language in itself. Just like we learn English, just like we learn mathematics, learning software is a way of expressing our ideas and unlocking our thoughts into manifestations that people call technology or solutions or this, that, or other things. So that is why I think it is incredibly fundamental. And goes back to my opening comments about it's no longer a vertical, it is a horizontal that touches every industry that's out there. So I think that's really the way to think about software. Don't look at it as I'm a software engineer or a mechanical engineer or this, that, or the other thing. Regardless of who you are, you could be an accountant. And I think understanding software and learning software is going to be incredibly useful and important to express your work into ways that people can interact with you more. Another beautiful thing about software is nobody can meaningfully predict what the world is going to look like in 5 years, 6 years, or 7 years from now. So I think about software similar to how you look at transformer toys. It's a platform. It allows you to build platforms. So just like you can mold a transformer toy to become multiple things very, very quickly, software allows you to do that through platforms and through modules. And agility and adaptability are two key attributes that every one of us should have if we want to be successful in the future. And success is something that you define personally, and that's where software plays a key role.
So I agree, software is key. However, software without hardware or silicon is like having apple pie without a crust. Right? So you need both, right? And having help with the internet, you need both hardware and software to do what we need to get done. So for all of those of you out there thinking about going into software engineering, we still need some hardware engineers too. So make sure you go with someone.
Having grown up here and only known software, it's really hard to answer the question any other way. Yes, software, it is certainly the lifeblood of me and my family. I'll give you an example of what I'm working on now that'll give you an example of what they just described of software being everywhere. In order for a company, a pharmaceutical company, to get a new medicine to market, and there are lots of people dying of cancers, heart issues, they have respiratory pain management problems. To get those drugs to market takes about 14 years and about $4 billion. And there are lots of people in the trials, there are lots of hospitals involved, there's a lot of biology, a lot of chemistry, and there's a lot of data associated with those trials to make sure that the drugs are safe and effective. So our software, because I only know software and I'm not a biologist, I'm not a chemist, our software helps all the doctors and all the pharmaceutical leaders make all the right safe decisions for the patients in the trials and get those drugs to market faster. So now they have application software on their tablets, on their desktops, that help them make smarter decisions about the medicines that they're developing. And that's software helping the life sciences industry. And there's, as they described, any industry has these challenges. But I think what's really exciting is that Silicon Valley and the biotech world have converged here in the Bay Area, and it's very, very exciting what software is able to do to help get the medicines and cures to the right people sooner.
Yes, I'm sure all of us here agree that software is king in Silicon Valley, and no matter what career or path you take, software will always be there in Silicon Valley, because it's the heart of Silicon Valley. So this kind of ties into our next question, which is, what is your advice for the youth of Silicon Valley as they embark upon all the choices and career?
Advice, it's really an exciting place to grow up. I don't have, are all of you born and raised here in Silicon Valley, all the kids? Are you from Silicon Valley? Yeah, everyone? Are all the kids? No, only a few? Who's from here? Who's from Silicon Valley? Kids, are you guys from here? Yeah, a few of you? Not all of you? Okay. I think you're some of the luckiest kids in the world because you get to grow up here. Because Steve Jobs was my neighbor. Because Bill Gates came down last week and I got to meet with him because he likes to meet with Silicon Valley entrepreneurs. This is an amazing place we live in. Accessible to you are some of the most amazing entrepreneurs who've created Facebook, who created every software company. Those folks live right here in Silicon Valley. So you have access to those people through college programs, through the companies you end up working with. But the idea is, if you can find a way to take advantage of where you live and the access to people like who are on this panel, to really understand how to take your skills and apply them to a really hard problem out there, you too, I think, will have the opportunity to live the Silicon Valley dream.
So the way you gotta think about the valley is two things, innovation and entrepreneurship. And this gives you a place to benefit from a lot of resources and a lot of thought leadership, as well as resources from money and guidance that you can get. As long as you've got the drive for innovation and entrepreneurship, do anything you want. It doesn't matter. It doesn't even have to be technology. But you've got to be really good at it, and you've got to be a business person, and then innovate in technology or business models to be able to make that happen. That's what I would like.
So I'll say it slightly differently, but related to my panelists here. The key to any success, in my opinion, and I say success is something that you define, not wealth or achievement in somebody else's yardsticks. So the beautiful thing about Silicon Valley is it's a world of contrarians. You can define your own yardstick for success. You don't have to believe that somebody is successful, so I can exactly mimic that person. So you can define your own yards. So in terms of building a career and so on and so forth, the way I would describe it is, first and foremost, work incredibly hard. Work incredibly hard. Whatever you're doing, work incredibly hard. Two is gather results. Gather results. Keep gathering results, whatever those might be. Three is be incredibly humble about it. And what I will assure you, if you do one, two, and three, is that you'll be incredibly irresistible. Everybody will want you on their team, everybody will want to put money into you, everybody will celebrate you. So in that regard, what I would say as it relates to career and education is define your own yardsticks, follow what you think is best for you. In that regard, I would say experiment. Don't worry about experimenting. Just because I have two children, neither of them wants to be a software engineer, I'm fine with that. Okay? They've seen me and decided what not to be. And that's okay. So I think it's important that going back to very, very basic things, work incredibly hard, be very adaptable, and be very agile. When Kenny talks about innovation, the way I interpret that is you have to have agility in your thought process. You need to be passionate about what you're doing in the current second. Next day, if you think your idea is outdated, get on to the next one. Don't be so dogmatic and pedantic that you're going to stick to something and the world is running and racing past it.
So I'm going to take a little bit different way to answer the question. What I want you guys to be ready to do is to reinvent yourself. I'll give you my work history. The decade of the 1980s, I worked in supercomputers. The decade of the 1990s, I took that supercomputer technology into silicon. So I worked in the semiconductor industry. Then I went into EDA in the early 2000s and then into social games. And now I'm working in biotech. All right? So why is that? Because there's such a pace of change that industries consolidate, and as they consolidate, you need to be able to move on to the next thing. So constantly keep curious, keep learning, and be ready to reinvent yourself.
Absolutely. I think I would second what they said, that the industry is changing so absolutely fast that there's no way you can set yourself on the ground. But I would add something on this that don't you love? These things are hard. They're long hours. And when you love what you do, you don't care, right? Because it's the curiosity, it's the trying to get to the solution that inspires you, right? And then the rest of it, you'll spend the hours at Curry Ducks putting those baskets in because you love what you do. And I remember this was when I was early on and I was a programmer. I worked for mobile web of all places. And I'd been working on this one problem, so I'm trying to solve a software program. And it was midnight, sitting in the office trying to solve the problem, couldn't get to it, couldn't solve it. So fine, I'm just going to go home and eat. Driving home, sitting at a red light, and the solution comes to me. What do? Big U-turn, right back into the office. Does anyone know I do that? No. Do I care? No. I love what I do. I love what you do. And when you do, the rest of it just comes.
Yeah, so they all talk about how following your passion is important. And even though that Silicon Valley is evolving rapidly, doing what you want to do and what you like to do is the most important thing. So our next question will be, the evolution of Silicon Valley from the 60s to today, is all this evolution positive? And is there anything that you could change or boost your confidence?
Well, thank God I didn't say I was not in Silicon Valley in the 60s. I'll at least stop my aging right there. Maybe I'll answer the question from what I want to see. I work for Intel, and we've been doing quite a bit in diversity. And I struggle because I have two girls, and both of them think the sky is the limit. The sky is the limit as to what they can do in Silicon Valley. If they work for a tech company, absolutely. Is there any restrictions? Girls, no way. They can do anything anyone else can do, as long as they put their heart and minds to it. What I want to see is that to stay, that to continue. Because somehow, right about this age is when it starts to change. It's that middle school age. We can do, any one of us are capable of making a major impact in Silicon Valley and being a part of what is the future of Silicon Valley. Women, boys, girls, this is opportunity available to all of us. And my wish, my dream, is that we keep that childhood hunger, that childhood view of anything is possible into Silicon Valley. And beyond.
That was awesome, Dippy. I'd like to build on that. I've lived all over the United States as a kid growing up, and finally, I guess a little bit into my career, moved to Silicon Valley. This place is the best place on the planet. There's access to investment capital. There's access to human capital. All the people that you want to work with all the knowledge that's going to make your enterprise better. And it is a meritocracy. So people that work hard, people that contribute, are the people that are rewarded. And it doesn't matter what your gender is, it doesn't matter what your age is, it doesn't matter what your ethnicity is. It just, what matters is what do you do? And this is the place that's like that. We all know other places around the world where there are prejudices, and what may their prejudices on all those things I just mentioned and lots more. But in Silicon Valley, there's less of that, and that's why I want to raise my kids here and have them grow up in that kind of environment.
Excellent. So I can easily agree with this is the best place in the world to live, and this is probably the greatest place in the world for creating opportunity and participating in opportunity. I'm going to continue to take a slightly contrarian view as we talk through the various topics here. Because a lot of the kids here are going to shape how Silicon Valley will be in 2020 and 2030 and so on and so forth. So some, Shivaum asked a very interesting question as to how the industry or Silicon Valley has changed from the 60s to the 70s and so on and so forth. And I'll share Dinuba's point, which is I was here in the 60s and my career started really in the 90s, early 90s. But there have been some fundamental changes that we have to caution ourselves and keep ourselves grounded as we evolve. In the early days, I mean, let's go back to the large system people here, Fairchild Semiconductor, HP even, and so on and so forth. People did things because they wanted to do something that they were passionate about. They wanted to change the world. They wanted to help people become more productive. They wanted to make life easy for others, and so on and so forth. Money was nowhere in the equation. Money was nowhere in the equation. Unfortunately, I would say we suffered a period between 1995, 96, I would say, to about 2001, when money became the thing in Silicon Valley. A lot of people got caught up where they felt like they could show up and become rich. Not that they could show up, innovate, work hard, produce results, make others better, and as a result, become rich. So there are those elements still in Silicon Valley, and my only word of caution would be, as you navigate your education, as you navigate your success, there's nothing wrong about amassing money. There's absolutely nothing wrong about that. But there is something wrong about only the pursuit of money. And that will make you do suboptimal things, and that's the one word of caution I would give.
That was a contrary, that was awesome.
Yeah.
So having grown up in Canada, I can tell you that this is the best place, the best weather, and the best amount of good things you can do with a single day. You can be in the snow, the dry land, and the beach all in one day. So that's something you've got to be able to cherish and enjoy and do outdoor activities all day long. However, when I look at Silicon Valley, I wasn't here in the 60s. I do know that the amount of growth the Valley has incurred over the last 30 years, we cannot accommodate that amount of growth over the next 30 to 40 years. So what we have to do is, we're a model. We're a model not just for the country or the nation, but for the world. We're a model for how to drive some of this entrepreneurship, how to drive some of this business model thinking, how to drive this investment capital and the human capital. And what we need to do is be that model and allow other values to emerge so that the world can become Silicon Valley and not just have it just being maintained here. So that's, I think, what we should be aiming for over the next 30 years.
Well, I actually have been here since the 60s. So I really date myself there. So I have seen all the change. My father was one of the first software engineers at Hewlett Packard back when it was less than 100 people. So I got to see the very beginning of the software industry boom. I saw the silicon component of it develop, and what I can say about my love for the Silicon Valley, it's because the entrepreneurs keep coming and coming up with more, better, innovative ways of approaching problems and solving problems using technology. And it never fails, and whether it's because Stanford and Cal keep putting out great people, or the propaganda of the weather draws the best entrepreneurs here, for whatever reason they come, I'm ecstatic, even though it clogs up the freeways.
I love the fact that innovation is truly in the water here in Silicon Valley, and that we continue to reinvent ourselves. So every time there's a crash, those of us that have been here since the beginning in the 60s, we know that the comeback's here to come. It's going to be the next generation that's going to get us there. So it's a really dynamic place to be and live, because we can be confident that we will recover from any transitions or shifts out there in the market that cause our stock market or high-tech stocks to crash, et cetera. Which the question was, is there anything that I would change? And it would definitively be the fact that I really think we need one of you all to invent an alternative mode of transportation, because clearly cars and freeways can't handle this. So I didn't see any of those when I looked around the table, but if you could figure out a drone that could get me to and from work, or something that helped me avoid the freeways, that would be a fundamental change I would hope for, is a little improved quality of life, a little less time on the road.
So everything that's happened in the past is Silicon Valley brought to what Silicon Valley is today, and how this is Silicon Valley's center of software and innovation, and how in Germany they're saying we can come along with the rest of the world, and then the entire world can become Silicon Valley. So all of you guys have many accomplishments. So what do you think your aha moment was that brought you to the past?
I think probably the biggest aha moment I've had was, and I'm talking to the kids out there, two teenage sons who know this story as well. I was very excited about software and passionate about software when I was very young, and it taught me how to solve problems more than it taught me how to code, and yeah, I learned on languages you would never have heard about, but the aha moment for me was when I took all that coding knowledge and applied it actually to solving business problems. So moving from just a coder and someone who really had strong technical skills to a business entrepreneur where I could see a problem and knew how software was going to fix that. And that occurred with my very first company that I founded, and I can remember seeing the problem so clearly and knowing that the skills that me and my friends had in technology could actually solve that problem, and we could start a company and become part of the Silicon Valley fabric. But I will never forget certainly my early 20s when we started, when I started my very first company.
So I call myself a plumber because I'm in the networking business, and what I've done all my life is connect things. When I was young, we were connecting businesses. That was a handful of places that you had to connect in the city. Then we went to connecting homes. Now connecting people or mobile devices. So in the future, connecting anything and everything that's either fixed or it's moving. And when you think about what that enables, that was my aha moment, which is, wow, look at what connectivity can enable. However, being an engineer, I always admire complexity. Complexity typically means profitability or gross margin and dollars, right, for a business. However, for a normal user, my aha moment was that simplicity, ease of use, and speed is what matters to all of us. It's not, we don't care about what happens and how it happens. We just want to know that what we want to get done actually is going to get done very simply. What made Apple what it did actually the ease of use on the iPhone or the iPod or the person around. That's what made the company do what it did. And a lot of other companies are trying to mimic that. Uber, it's the simplicity. DoorDash, it's the simplicity. Ease of use. And that's the simple theme that's the aha moment for me. And that'll actually continue forever. Is that anything we can simplify and make ease of use better, of course software is going to make it possible, is going to drive that.
I would say that I'm still searching for my aha moment because every time I think I've figured it out, there is a new surprise. So you're constantly reinventing yourself to your earlier point, Dave. But going back early into my career when I was fresh out of grad school, we all come out of grad school with some fancy research and theses and we think we'd make it. I joined a company which had 50 of probably the best engineers that I've ever worked with. So, and the person that I worked for seemed to know everything that I could think of and everything that I could not think of. And so it kept going back to how did this person do it? Is it that he was born like this? How did he become what he became? And honestly, my first very first aha moment was there was no substitute to hardware. I had a very simple goal when I started working for him after 3 months, which was to arrive at work or leave from work earlier or later than him at least once. And it took me a year to do that. So there is no substitute to an incredible work ethic, which is why I would say it shaped my early days. But similar to what Kelly spoke about in terms of connecting, and connecting the dots and so on and so forth. The way I would describe myself is that in the early part of my days coming from the networking world, I felt my job in life was to help people communicate better, connect with each other, communicate with each other, send emails, search webs, and so on and so forth. Later part of my career, it was all about focusing on helping them collaborate better, doing video conferencing, voice conferencing, and so on and so forth. And now I would say using technologies like virtualization, cloud, and security, and so on and so forth, is to help people become more productive, whatever that may be. So that's how I've been evolving my journey, and I'm still searching for my aha moment.
When I was a little kid, every now and then I would break something. And my dad would pull me to the side, and he would look at me, and he would say, "Davey," Davey, Holtz build things, Holtz don't break things. So my whole life, that's what I have pursued, and I build companies now, and we've had lots of exits, and from IPOs to M&As. But my aha moment is a company that I was working at for years, and it was never gonna hit the hockey stick growth. Because of the consolidation in the semiconductor space. And my aha moment was, you know what? We need to shut this company down. So I would urge all of you to go after your passion, pursue it, but constantly measure your success and decide when, oh, you know what? I need to evolve my thinking and move on to the next thing.
Okay, so I'll take a slightly different take on this. So a few years ago, I had a little bit of a midlife crisis in my office, where I went through, what am I work in the semiconductor industry, make good amount of money. What am I doing to make this world a better place? What am I doing to leave a legacy? What am I doing to actually make an impact? And am I making an impact, right? And so it's a self-reflection and lots of, a long time, and I had an aha moment as I was walking through the airport. I saw a gentleman sitting in the corner. He had his iPhone with him, plugged into the wall. He was deaf and mute, and he was sitting with his phone, and it was sign language. He was using sign language through FaceTime to talk to his loved ones. And as I walked back, I said, "Okay, we are making it." This one person probably could have never used a cell phone, never been able to communicate, is now from simple technology like FaceTime, and it's not simple, it's a lot of very, very complicated things inside that to work on. because we all, I think, innately are here because, and I look around and see a lot of the projects. There's one on how do we save water, right? How do we make things more efficient? We all want to make an impact. What we do is actually making an impact. And so making that connection for yourself and for others around you is very inspirational.
Thank you all for sharing your I think it was very important that all you guys had these challenges because of you guys wanted to connect with people and create a solution in problem solving. So that wraps up our panel session today. Let's give them all a round of applause.
And quick announcement, we have coffee here, we have So, you know, when you look at Silicon Valley, what is that factor that contributes to the Silicon Valley success? You know, I would love to get some kids to tell me. So why is Silicon Valley successful? Is it because of the water we breathe? Is it the water we drink? Or the air we breathe? Yeah, why is Silicon Valley so successful? Somebody? Yes, so what I'm hearing is because of senators, because of council members, yes, but something happened before that. What happened before that? Something happened before that, yes.
Okay, it's the people, Silicon Valley people who are
the people, yes.
The ideas. And it's innovation.
The people, but what brought the people here? What brought the people here? Technology. So what jump-started technology? What jump-started technology?
Innovation.
Innovation. But what happened to create that innovative platform? What happened? What happened? There was something that happened. The chip industry happened and that gave birth to Silicon Valley. Do we agree on that? The chip industry. Can anyone name me a chip industry company? Anyone?
That's logic.
Adults, come on, the kids. Okay, so what about something happened before Intel was formed, before the chip industry? What happened? There's a university that was formed in 1876, very close to us, close by.
Stanford. You know,
Stanford, that's the right answer. Stanford, you know, Stanford, the dean of Stanford, he was.